Facing challenges and overcoming setbacks is part of doing business. Whether you have the expertise to survive them or not could mean the difference between success or failure. Welcome to We Are Women, featuring revealing conversations that provide invaluable insights into the success secrets of female masterminds. A must listen for every entrepreneurial woman. Now here's your host, Janine Vosper.
Hi, it's Janine Vosper here, and welcome to this episode of the We Are Women podcast. Today, I have Angela Council. Now, Angela is a leading naturopath and menopause coach, and she guides women to embrace the changes that are happening to their body as they move through the menopause transition. She is on a mission to spread the word that it is possible to thrive in menopause, and that this can be a time for stepping into your wisdom and falling in love with yourself and your life. As a qualified naturopath and kinesiologist of almost 20 years experience supporting women through various stages of their life, Angela understands how hormones can impact the way in which a woman feels and looks. Angela runs her own successful natural therapies clinic in Sydney, the Amber Tree, for 10 years, and she now continues to consult privately with her clients, as well as running regular retreats and group programs and women's circles. Angela hosts a popular podcast called Wise Women Conversations, where she has enlightening conversations with other women and provides practical advice to support women to navigate menopause with ease. She's also self-published author of the book Secret Mum's Business, and it reached number one status on Amazon in health and lifestyle and business categories. Angela has been featured in several magazines, television, radio programs, including Prevention, Good Health, Channel 7's The Morning Show, Channel 10's The Project, that as well, 2UE and 3AW Radio, Natural Spirit Speaks, KC Radio 97.3, and many other podcasts and radio shows. Wow, welcome, Angela.
Hello, Janine, how are you?
I'm great. That sounds very exhausting, but it sounds like you are the go-to person when people want to know about menopause. And it's such a important topic, because so many of the listeners I know they're either pre-menopause or going through menopause, and it is can be such a really difficult time, or it can be an easier time depending on which way you look at it. Mm-hmm. Tell me why this, as a naturopath and kinesiologist, you've focused on the menopause.
Well, I didn't originally. When I very first graduated, so I was in the corporate world, and then I left corporate and started to study to become a naturopath. And whilst I was studying, I fell pregnant with my first child, then I fell pregnant with my second child. So I spent 5 years whilst I was studying either pregnant or breastfeeding, and that was in my 40s. So I had my first child at 40, my second at 43. And kind of when I came out of all of that, I went into practice, and I started off working with women who had new bubs. And then as my kids got older, then I was working with women that had toddlers, and then my kids went to school. And so my clients have always been a few years behind me. So now that I'm kind of at the other end, and my son's about to go off to uni on the weekend, he's leaving me.
Oh, no.
On the weekend, he's going to Canberra to live. And I still got one more that's got two more years of school. But as my life's changed, and as I've actually moved through menopause, one of the things that I realized that even when I studied, we weren't taught that much about menopause. We were taught about hot flushes, vaginal dryness, that's about it, moodiness. I went through this stage of life and realized that there was so much more to it. And the biggest thing for me, yes, I had some physical symptoms, but the biggest thing was, who the hell am I? I felt lost for a very long time, and I probably was going through the bulk of all this emotional turmoil as my youngest finished primary school. There was a big time, there's a time when I was kind of going, what the hell am I doing? I'm running this business. I've done all this stuff, and, all that stuff that you read out. Yeah, I was burning myself out. And then I was going, why am I doing this? What's it for? And I actually kind of pulled myself back in for a while. It got to the end of the year. My daughter was graduating school and I kind of had a complete breakdown. I was in the middle of the floor going, what the hell am I doing? Why am I doing this? And so I cancelled all my clients, took a couple of months off, and basically I sat in front of the television and watched Law and Order on repeat and read books. And I did that for a couple of months because I just didn't know what else to do. And in hindsight, it was good that I did that. It was actually good that I took that time away, because later that year, my husband was diagnosed with cancer. And that was a big journey in itself. And at least because I'd had that break, I actually had the reserves to be able to support him and then support the kids and all of that. And that was kind of when I was full on in my transition through what was going on with me. And as I spoke to more and more women who were the same age as me, they're all feeling the same. They didn't know who they were anymore. And you know, we got these physical symptoms. For me, my biggest physical symptom was I was in massive pain. So I had joint and body pain, and it went on for years, and I didn't sleep properly for years. Yes, I had some hot flushes and that, and I started to put weight on because I was in pain and I couldn't exercise, and I was trying everything. But I was confused, I was lost, I was kind of going in, what can I do? And I was going and looking at all these different modalities and techniques and everything that I knew. And I then kind of went, well, if I'm going through this and I've got this knowledge, what is everyone else going through? Because they don't know what I know.
That's an important factor, isn't it, Angela? And sometimes when we are the professional, you know, inverted commas, saying that, we even are harder on ourselves because that expectation is higher, because the word should comes up. We should know how to do this because we're supposedly helping other people to do it at the same time. And then we put that a lot more pressure on ourselves, and that higher level of judgment of who do you think you are if you can't even handle it for yourself, let alone for others.
And a big one with that for me was weight. Mm. Now, I've always been able to relatively keep my weight pretty stable. And if I wanted to lose a few kilos, I would just go on the keto diet, drop off what I needed to, and it was fine. It wasn't working like that anymore. And my weight was piling on, and it was piling on and piling on. And I tried to do keto diet and I just struggled. I couldn't do the keto diet. Look, it was just, you know, it's what I'd done for years, but it just wouldn't work. And I couldn't stick to it. It was just too hard. And then I was becoming really, really embarrassed and shameful, because here I was teaching women about being healthy and I couldn't lose weight. Now, this is a big issue for a lot of women as they go through menopause. So I needed to understand why this is happening. Why didn't it work the way it used to? Why couldn't I lose weight like I did before? So that took me down a really big rabbit hole to learn what was happening, how much impact was my hormones having, and what was going to be my solution going forward. And I was looking at, you know, there were people out there saying, oh, keto is the best thing for women in menopause, and this is the best thing, and this is the best thing. And then I found out about personalized health. And with personalized health, we basically use genetics plus what we call epigenetics, which is where your body is right now, and creating a health program based on who you are as an individual. And it's not the same for every person. So once I learned about that, and then I trained in that and became accredited in that, and started to follow it myself and started to do it myself, and realized that what I'd been doing in the past wasn't right for where my body was right now, where my hormones were right now. And I started to actually just follow, you know, eating at a certain times and eating certain foods and exercising at certain times that were specific to me, and the weight just started to come off. Now, I've lost 15 kilos in the last 12 months, but I've kept it off for that 12 months. So, and it's easy for me now because it's now a lifestyle. So now I know that there isn't a single solution, but for a long time I was going, why can't I do it? So I was very much ashamed, and I wouldn't talk about diet. I didn't talk about diet for a long time. I'm going, I don't do weight loss. And I don't do weight loss, but I do being healthy. Yeah. And being healthy for me is weighing less than I did before.
I know for me, I mean, I'm in my 60s now, and I found I taught aerobics for 10 years, and I used to be a runner and do fitness training. And I found in the last 3 years, it's just, it's as you get older, it sort of gets more difficult to move weight, or again, because if you've got joint issues or different things happening to you, not as active. But it becomes, and I don't want to use the word impossible because I don't want to put that out into the universe, but it's that difficulty when you just, for me, and I'm assuming this is what you're talking about, and it just hit an absolute roadblock where it does, nothing you do can change it. So you sort of go, oh, stuff it. You know, yeah. You get that whole attitude that, I don't care about that. And I know, and talking about the personalized, my husband and I are starting some personalized stuff with metabolic balance.
Oh, yes.
Yes, with our individual needs, because, and they'll be very different from each other, what we need.
And what you need now is different to what you needed 10 years ago.
Mm.
And this is, I've always said in the past, oh, well, don't worry about what you weigh, because we get into, we don't want to get into body shaming, but also, I know how my body feels now and how it felt when I was holding the extra weight. So whilst it was, I didn't want to be ashamed of my body where it was, I'm a lot prouder of where it is right now because I can move better. I can, do things. I love going out walking in the bush and scrambling over rocks. It's a lot easier when I don't have to be carrying that extra 15 kilos on my body, because I can pull myself up and I'm stronger and I'm more flexible and things like that. And the pain's gone because I did have a lot of, joint pain. Now I can move. So it is really about, we need to understand that as our hormones shift, so hormones are very, very powerful and they're chemical messages that tell our body what to do. And as our reproductive hormones shift, and it's not just reproductive hormones, other hormones shift as well, but as they shift, our body changes. But we keep, as women, keep thinking that whatever worked before will work now, but it won't, because our body is not the same as what it was then. It's the same as when we came through puberty, our body changed. Now, as we go through menopause, our body is basically, I call it puberty in reverse. We are going back to being in puberty. We've just got all this extra baggage to go with it, but our body is not the same. And this is a big myth that, we really need to bust, is because women are going, but, I want it to be like it was before. Mm. It's not. It can't be like it was before because your hormones are not the same as they were before. They are doing different things. We don't need as much hormone as what we did before because we're not producing eggs anymore. We've got no eggs left. So we don't need as high level as hormone anymore because we don't have to support the potential life that we had when we were releasing an egg every month. So things are different. And then those hormones don't work alone. Reproductive hormones work with our thyroid hormones. They work with our blood sugar hormones. They work with our stress hormones. They work with all these different hormones. And when one lot of hormones starts to shift, so do other hormones start to shift. And we need to find a new calibration of everything because that's who we are now. Our bodies are changing. And this is what, I say, I want women to embrace the changes rather than fight the changes, embrace them.
Yeah.
Embrace that this is who you are going forward. And we are so privileged to be living the life we're living right now because we go back a couple of generations and women did not live much longer past them moving through their menopause transition. We're halfway there. We have the opportunity to do whatever we like for the second half of our lives. As our children leave, it's like we're not dying at 50 anymore. No. Hopefully we're making it to, 90 to 100. We got so many more years to go. And if we start to just accept that this is who the new person is, the new body, the new persona, because, most women as they come through this type of life start to not give a damn about what other people think about them. And they kind of go, whatever. But that's the part of the new you.
Mm.
And embracing who you are and knowing that you've got a wisdom. Women in this time of life have got a wisdom, a real wisdom that the world needs. The world needs our wisdom.
And that goes back to you, what you were saying before when you were looking for your why. Your why are you doing this? That's such an important factor because I know I work with women who, exactly what you're saying, hit that mark and their children leaving home and all of a sudden, you know, there's just two people in the relationship and not the whole family. Or they may have been single parenting and then they're left by themselves and discovering that as human beings, we need to be able to contribute. We need to be able to, that's what sets us apart from the animals is being accountable to ourselves and contributing to the world, not just existing. And that's that sense, isn't it? When we are looking for that why is how can we contribute to the world in the best way we can that's going to nourish our souls at the same time.
Yeah. And we've got to look at ourselves first, because one thing that most women by the time they get to this time of life, and this is what causes most of the symptoms, is the fact that they've ignored their own needs. They've given to everybody else. You know, they've raised children, they've been a partner, they've been a daughter, they've been a sister, they've been an employee, they've been a business owner, they've given to everybody. Mm. They get to this time of life and they are exhausted. And this plays a really big role in the balance of our hormones, our stress levels, the symptoms that you can experience, because we've forgotten to look after ourselves. Mm. And when we start to turn that around and actually start to focus on ourselves and, you know, feed ourselves properly, move and reduce our stress, all of that, then our body has the opportunity to truly blossom into the next stage of life. But, you know, we have spent so many years serving others that we've forgotten about serving ourselves first. And when we start to serve ourselves first, we can actually serve so many more people because we've got energy and we're full of life and we've got a real purpose.
You know, this theme comes up in so many of the interviews, no matter whether I'm talking about health or even business or marketing or whatever, it's that serving self first. And it's, you know, the airline thing to put your own oxygen mask on before you put it on somebody else. But it's such an important factor. And I know I've brought this up in other podcasts, but I've spoken to women's leadership events. And, you know, one of the questions I ask is, what do you do for yourself? And it is. It's just there's no answer. People don't have that answer. And these, you know, this particular group I'm thinking of, with executive women in you know, in top roles in industry and government, and it's that lack of supporting self. They're just doing their job, and then they question that their ability to do that also.
Yeah, and supporting yourself first could be as simple as, you just picked it up. Did you know what I was about to say? This?
No.
Drinking enough water. That could be as simple as that. Drinking enough water. Or it could be choosing something more nourishing for your food. You know, having a more nourishing lunch rather than the fast food down the road. That is looking after yourself first.
I'm just saying, I'd sit here with every interview and I have that's just filtered water I refill. And
so many women are dehydrated. Mm. You know, and particularly women who are really, really busy, they're running around doing everything and they don't have time to stop and have a glass of water. Now, I have a pot of tea with me all the time. So I drink tea, even in hot weather. And part of it is just really just taking the time to breathe. Going, I'm going to have a drink right now. And, you know, and a drink of water, tea, not alcohol, wine. Yeah. Because we don't even give ourselves time, particularly these high-powered women who are in positions who are very much in their masculine energy. You know, they are, you know, they're very successful, but they're in their masculine energy of do, do, do. And they're not in they've forgotten about their feminine energy of nurture and self-love.
Mm. And so particularly when women are in that situation and it is that do, 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 whether you're working in executive or working in your own business and creating, going through menopause then, or premenopause and menopause, then what sort of struggle and symptoms and, you know, do you see in your clinic that people are, we've talked about pain and we've talked about hot
the
flushes.
Biggest ones, the two biggest ones are hot flushes and weight gain. And then there's the moods. Now, and joint pain does come along there as well, but hot flushes, because I'm actually in the middle of doing a hormone reset right now. And I've been asking women, well, what are your issues around menopause? And just about every single one of them, hot flushes, weight. And it's just the two of the, you know, just those things. And then you'll get the moods. Yeah. And some women are extremely angry at this time of life. They feel like there's a lot of anger coming up. And if we look at that, you know, and they don't understand why they're angry. And in Chinese medicine, we have, there's lots of meridians, and the liver is the seat of anger. And the liver is also where hormones are made and broken down and looked after. And so we need to actually have a healthy liver to have healthy hormones. And the majority of women are drinking just way too much alcohol, which is putting a load on their liver, which is throwing the hormones out of balance, which is making them very angry. And the cycle just continues, because then they go and have a glass of wine to calm themselves down and they can't sleep at night. So then they're angry the next morning and it just keeps going on and on and on. So we need to break some cycles. What we used to do before won't work. We need to start focusing, what is our body telling us? Because our body gives us messages. You know, if you've hot flushes, once again, is heat. That's anger. So that's coming from the liver. It's also coming from stress, too much stress. So cortisol levels are too high. Our blood sugar levels are too high, triggers hot flushes. And then weight, once again, is to do with our diet and our lifestyle. It's all exactly the same thing. And I've got five pillars that I work with my clients. And actually, these are the same things I wrote about when I wrote my book many, many years ago, Secret Mum's Business, which was helping women, mums who ran their own business, to kind of find a work-life balance. It's the same stuff. I keep talking about the same stuff. I just kind of reinvent it for the next, because it's not new. Mm-hmm. We need to be eating food that nourishes our body. We need to be moving our body in a way that our body needs to be moved, like regularly, the way it likes moving. We need to reduce the toxicity in our life. We need to reduce the stress in our lives. And we need to change our mindset and our belief systems around aging and menopause, because many women believe that menopause will be a struggle because that's what they've been told. And if you believe menopause will be a struggle, it will be a struggle. But I know that you can actually change your menopause journey. I've done it. The clients I work with have done it. And it is possible to thrive in menopause, and we need to believe that. But if we believe it's going to be a struggle, game over.
Yeah, that's a really important factor. So just going over those five again, because I want to make sure that I do put them in the podcast notes. So you talked about food that nourishes the body.
Yeah, so food, and I use a personalized approach, but in general, we need to be eating more plants. Mm-hmm. Now, plants have chemicals in them called phytoestrogens, and they help to balance up our natural estrogen. So we need more plants. A lot of people are not eating enough plant foods. And we don't need quite as much animal protein. Animal protein can be quite, for some people, can be quite inflammatory and can cause more pain. We don't need quite as much protein now that we're not bleeding every single month, we're not producing an egg every single month. So we can actually reduce the protein a little bit, and we actually need to reduce our calories. So we need to eat the right foods based on your body type. And that's what I do with personalized health. But in general, eat more veggies, eat less red meat. Don't eat any processed foods, drink more water. We need to move. Mm. And, you know, for some people, the best way to move their bodies is to run. That's not me.
No, it's not. It used to be me, but it's definitely not me anymore. I remember having a conversation with a orthopedic surgeon. He said every time he drives past runners, he just sort of cheers because he knows that eventually he'll be a client.
Yeah, well, I had an orthopedic surgeon once after I went in for my fourth knee operation. He says, look, you can either give up running or I'll just continue going on holidays every year. So I gave up running. My body is actually not designed to run. And now that I understand this myself, I know that my body is better to be wearing, you know, to be bearing weight. So yeah. Me going out for a hike is great. So I go out in nature and hike and use my strength where I've got my strength. So, but we need to move our body in a way that our body wants to move. And it has to be fun. People say, well, what's the best type of exercise? Like, well, what do you enjoy doing? Don't do something you don't enjoy doing. I don't enjoy running, and I ran for years and years, and all it did was give me injuries.
Exactly the same, Angela. I used to, the first mile or the first kilometre, I'd be just talking to myself all the time, going, I don't want to be out here. It's too hot. It's too cold. And boobs are bouncing. I, you know what, backs or whatever. I would just have all these excuses going on and on and on. And after I got out the first K, I just kept running then. It wasn't that bad, but it wasn't great for my body, and I didn't like it. And I watch runners now, and I and walkers, and I'm a heavy walker. I walk heavily and run heavily, and it's got nothing to do with weight. It's just how I do it. And I've watched each morning when I do go for a walk around the parks and that here, and I watch some people run past and big blokes that are as light as a feather on their feet, and then I see other blokes or women that are quite light and they run past and they still are running heavy. And it took me a long time to realize that teaching aerobics for 10 years was the worst thing I could have done with my body. But and you know, hence you end up with all the injuries. But it's just what I did because you wanted to be very fit, and that were the two things that gave you the most fitness.
And we were told that's the best way to exercise. I used to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and do boot camp. I used to hate it. I wasn't very good at it, so I used to sit there the whole time or stand there thinking there was something wrong with me because I couldn't keep up with everybody else. Mm. I now understand that the best time for me to exercise and to be doing heavy exercise is in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. And when I do exercise in the afternoon, I have got so much strength and so much power. But try and get me doing boot camp early in the morning. My body just doesn't move and doesn't have its power first thing in the morning. So yoga is great for me first thing in the morning. But not going and doing boot camp. But I always was taught exercise first thing in the morning, get in over and done with, and you'll be great all day. I wasn't. I'd exercise in the morning, and then I couldn't move for the rest of the day, and I was exhausted.
Yeah, it's important. It's so important to know that and to know what is good for the body. Do you work that around Chinese medicine, or
that's part of personalized health, which does have Chinese medicine included. It also has Ayurvedic health included as well. Plus also our traditional science. So it's very much similar. It's very, very similar to metabolic balance. Mm-hmm. So because I know a couple of practitioners that do metabolic balance, but I do PhD 60, very similar. Yep. We go very deep also into lifestyle, mindset, and all of that as well.
Mm. Yeah, and it is so important, and it's important to do what you like. I've got a friend of mine that goes dancing. That's her exercise. She loves it, and it's she does it, and that's the thing is what you do, what you love, you will do.
That's right. It's like and because one of the things is a lot of women, and exercise is a funny thing because women who are struggling with weight, and so they think they have to exercise more, but over-exercise is a big problem because what it does is stress the body, and once the body's stressed, it holds on to fat and it won't release it. So for years I've had women who come to me and say, I'm doing aerobics 2 hours a day every single day of the week and I can't lose weight. It's like, okay, well, could you just slow down and actually do some yoga and not exercise, every day? Because exercise is a stress on the body, and the body can take a certain amount, but when you overstress it, one of the things it does is it holds onto weight and it stores it around the middle. And then when you say, I'm not going to eat as much, I'm going to go on a diet, so then the body's gone to an automatically, my God, there's no food, I'm going to starve. So it holds on to whatever you do eat. And this is so typical. This is what we were taught as we were growing up. You want to lose weight, you've got to exercise more and you've got to eat less.
Yeah, that was simple, wasn't it? More, less calories in, more calories out. Yeah.
That was simple. And that might have worked when you had a body that was a little bit more adjustable.
Yeah, yeah. It did in your 30s. It really did, yeah.
Doesn't in your 50s. Doesn't in your 40s, your 50s and beyond. Because on top of that, if you didn't have any stress in the world and that was the only stress you had, that would probably be okay. Your body would deal with it. But you've got every other stress. And we live in a very, very stressful world. You know, emails are pinging at us left, right and center. I have watched the buzzers every time someone wants to ring me or whatever. And it's like,
I purposely don't have one of those watches.
We've got this stuff, and the brain, the primitive part of the brain, is seeing that as a danger. Every time an email comes in and you read an email and you get upset, all of a sudden the brain's gone into danger mode and it's gone into stress mode, so it's holding on to fat. We sit there and we watch stuff on TV. We watch the news, the nightly news every night. is so stressful. You sit there and you look at these riots that are going on, and the brain doesn't know that that's a video. Mm. It thinks you're in the middle of this riot and that you're about to die. So it actually changes the way the body works. And because we've been doing this for so many years, we are immune to it. We just, this is just normal life for us. We watch what's going on television, and it is just, you know, these days, what they show on television, and you will know that they would never have shown that 10, 15 years ago on television. You see dead bodies, you see blood, you see gore, you see all of that now. They show it to you on the nightly news. You know, 10, 15 years ago, we would not have seen that. They would have cut away, and you would not have seen that.
That's a good point.
But it's just normal.
And it may be consciously we're aware that it's just a video, and but subconsciously it's just being stored there as stress. Interesting point.
Yeah, and this is the way we live our lives. So we can't, there's some things we can control, some things we can't control. Because that cortisol, that stress, is impacting every other hormone in our body, and it impacts those reproductive hormones as well. So if you can control the amount of cortisol that's running through your body, you do what you can. You know, we'd all probably love to go, I would love to go, I've got a farm in Queensland that I'm not living on, and I'd love to go there and kind of lock the world out. I can't go there until my youngest has finished school. And even then, when I go there, I'm still not going to be able to lock the world out. But, you know, we can't do that. So what can we do? And there's certain things we can do. And some of the things that we can control is the food that we eat. Okay? We can eat food that doesn't stress our body. You know, and food that stresses our body is food that's full of chemicals, that's full of sugar, that's full of alcohol. It stresses our body. We can move our body in a way that doesn't stress our body. We can reduce the toxins that we're exposed to, because we're now back to the five. Number three was reducing the toxins.
Yeah, and that I interviewed a lady the other day, and she's got a hairdressing salon in Sydney, and she believes it's the only one in Australia that doesn't have toxins in any of their...
Oh, yes, I know who you're talking about.
Carly Fadoulis. Yes, and it was really interesting conversation with her journey and then how to get rid of the toxins. And
That was a big thing when I was in clinic, when and I used to... The two worst professions, because I used to do natural fertility, the two worst professions were women who were hairdressers and women who were air hostesses. They had the highest rate of fertility. And the hairdressers, because of the chemicals that they're constantly exposed to, and the air hostesses, or whatever they call them now.
Flight attendants.
Yeah, there's probably a yes.
Yeah. Actually, I probably call them unemployed flight attendants at the moment, which is so sad for them.
They're being exposed to radiation all of the time because of where they're flying, and that actually impacted their fertility as well. They were the two worst when it came to fertility. But then as those women are getting older, they're going to have more issues as they start to come through menopause, because unless they've addressed what's going on with their liver, and for many of those women, they then had to go and do IVF to have children, and IVF completely stuffs up your hormones. And the women who do menopause the worst, who have the biggest problems, are the women who've done IVF.
Wow. Okay. I've never heard that. Has anyone ever said that out loud before, that you need to know?
We don't talk about it.
No. And it's not something when you're trying to fall pregnant, I mean, your priority is that. It's not, something you're thinking.
And no one talks about it. Many of the general practitioners do not understand women's hormones. All they know is you come in with a problem, they either go, it's in your head, or here's a pill. They don't, unless they've done extra training, they don't understand women's hormones. I had to do extra training to understand it. I did it as part of my degree. I did human reproduction. And then since, I have gone a lot deeper to learn it. Most naturopaths, particularly when it comes to menopause, don't understand because we're not trained in it. If someone asked me once, they asked a question and they said, well, what do they teach you in naturopathic school? And I said, unfortunately, not a lot because they didn't.
It's all that extra learning to really understand, and particularly when you're working with a group of people, then that becomes your focus and your interest, and you want to learn as much as possible. So then you said, and mindset is the other one.
reducing your stress and your mindset. And beliefs play a massive, massive role. Mm. We live in a world which very much idolizes youth. And as women get older and they're past their reproductive stage, whether they've had children or not, there is no value in a woman that is no longer in a reproductive state of life. That's a general statement, obviously. Mm. But that's the way our society sees women. You're old. You've got no value. What are you here for? You can't have children anymore. You know, and we see this all the time. Yet it's the women in this time of life who actually have the wisdom. Our wisdom is not valued. And we're basically told, well, unless you look young, or, you know, once the wrinkles and the grey hairs turn up, you dye the hair and you put this, there's the ads out, you know, you put this stuff on your skin to make it look younger. It's like, why do I want to look younger? I don't want to look 20 anymore. I'm not 20. I want to look my age. And if that means I had a few wrinkles going on, that's actually okay. Mm. Because that shows my life.
Yes. I'm always, you know, very much into your beliefs and mindset. And I had a very easy menopause that just, and I just, it was my expectation, really, that it would be that way. And I use that in a lot of places in my life, you know. I just, well, expect to get the car park. I don't know, just there. It's just what it is. And yes, so that, it's very much, isn't it, that expectation, oh, mum had a really bad time through menopause. I know I'm going to struggle through it as well. And it's how we accept what we think is going to happen, as opposed to shifting that belief system, going, well, it doesn't necessarily have to be like that for everyone. You know, there was, other than the weight, which is, you know, to do with eating as well as everything else, it's for me, it was a breeze, which sounds
boring.
And it, sometimes it's a bit, you sound a bit cocky when you're saying how easy it was, because especially if people are struggling with different aspects of it. Mm-hmm. You know, there was definitely the power surges. I don't call them hot flushes. Never called them hot flushes. Yeah. Power surges. It'd be the power surges, and they'd be, oh, there you go. Oh, it's gone now. And that type of thing, you know. But yeah, and even, I don't know, that's just my way of dealing with it. Oh, okay. Did I sweat through the night? I don't know. I can't remember. Oh, well, doesn't matter. You know, rather than going, oh, my gosh, I was sweating every night and it was just, I don't know, I can't remember. It's a goldfish. I have a goldfish mentality when it comes to things like that.
But we need women like you to start sharing that story, because there's too many women out there, and, you know, Facebook is just full of them, because I've been part of so many Facebook groups for women in menopause, and everyone's telling the story about how bad it is. And as soon as you start to change the narrative, people kind of say, well, you don't know what it's like. But the thing is, it's not cocky to say, oh, it was pretty easy for me. That's actually normal. It is not normal to experience all these symptoms. It is normal for your period to stop. That is normal. Mm. And to be some slight adjustments, and then you move on with things. That's normal. What is common is all this stuff, and people are taking what's common and making it normal. And that's part of the problem, is because the narrative is, you know, women out there are very lost. I've spoken to so many women and they go, I don't understand what's going on. I feel lost. They have a sense of loss because they're losing their fertility. They feel confused and they don't know who to talk to. And when they kind of go out and start speaking, everybody tells them how bad it is, and the only solution is to go and take HRT and then you'll be fine, which isn't necessarily the truth, because women on HRT are not necessarily fine. But we need more women, and this is one of the reasons why I started my podcast. We need more women to say, you know, actually, this was the best time of my life. Mm. Yeah, I had a couple of, you know, there's a few days that are a bit of a not too okay, but I got through it and I actually thrived. And now, it's, you know, this is the next stage of my life, is the best stage of my life. We need more women having that conversation, so that those out there who are coming beyond us can actually know that it is possible, that there's something else besides suffering. That suffering is not the only way you can do it. It's optional.
No, and I think that's important. I mean, and it's all those things that you've said as well. You know, I've always eaten healthfully. I've eaten crap on top, but I've always eaten healthfully. I do like my wine, but that's, you know, moderation. I've always exercised. I've always moved the body, whatever that looked like at different stages of my life, and mindset. So, you know, it's all of those components definitely help. Yeah. I think that was my belief. Oh, well, that'll help. So that's what happens. Yeah. You know.
And it's not rocket science. Mm. What I'm talking about is not rocket science. It might be hard. And the biggest thing that women have is giving up alcohol. That's alcohol and caffeine. And they go, do I have to? I said, well, it depends. You've got symptoms. You might have to give them up until the symptoms go. And then you can decide whether or not you want the symptoms or you want the wine. I personally gave up drinking. Because I didn't drink much. I only would have Saturday night, I'd have a glass of wine with dinner, and I have spritzers. So it was half wine, well, half white wine and half mineral water. So I didn't drink much, and my diet was okay, yet I was still in pain, and I was in constant pain. And I was doing everything, and I was taking anti-inflammatories, herbal anti-inflammatories, and then one day I was just over being in pain and not being able to sleep. And I went, actually, I'm just going to stop all alcohol. Mm. And that was the Christmas before last, so 2 years ago. So
okay.
I went, no more. I haven't had anything since. Just stopping that small amount of alcohol was enough for my pain to disappear.
Mm, that's very powerful. That's a very powerful statement, isn't it? Yes.
I don't need to drink it now because, you know, I could probably drink now and not have the pain, but I've lost the taste for it. I'm fine. There's plenty of non-alcoholic wines out there. I drink Seedlip, which is a non-alcoholic gin infusion type thing. Mm-mm. I'm fine with that. I don't need the kick anymore.
No. Yeah. And it's how the liver is affected.
Yeah.
That's causing all that issue. No, that's I just on a thing, and I'm thinking how it could be worded with what you do. I remember asking my dentist, we were talking about flossing teeth, and I said, so do I need to, you know, floss them all the time? And she said, no, just floss the ones you want to keep. That's very clever. And I'm thinking how you could word that with the alcohol as well. It was
I'm pretty, you know, I've been told that sometimes I can be pretty blunt. It's like, well, you've got a choice.
Mm.
You know, you either want the symptom or you want the wine. And I've spoken to women and they go, it's okay, fine, I'll actually have the wine. It's okay, well, you know that that's going to impact you. But yeah, I'm actually okay with that. And because one way that you can tell whether or not alcohol is impacting you is if you're waking up between 1 a.m. and 3 a.m., now this is Chinese medicine, whether or not that's with a hot flush, having to go to the toilet, or you're just kind of waking up. If you're waking up at that time, that's liver time. So it's a good indication that the wine is causing some type of, you know, reaction in your body. And if you're okay with that, that's fine.
And is that if you've drunk alcohol that night, or is that if you drink alcohol at all?
It quite often will happen that night.
Okay. All right. Well, that's handy for all of us to pay attention to, I suppose.
If you know, if you've gone out and you've had a heavy night, you will generally wake up between 1 and 3 a.m. either to go to the toilet or you're just not feeling well. Yeah, and it could just be, it may not be a heavy night. It could be one alcoholic drink. We have got less capacity to drink alcohol as we get older for various reasons. Hormones is one, but also because we need specific nutrients to break alcohol down within the liver, and zinc is one of the key nutrients, plus some of the B vitamins. Many of us are deficient in those nutrients. Mm. And, the liver's just, it's been doing a lot of work for 50-odd years and it's just not working quite as efficiently as what it could do. So,
that's interesting. Definitely an interesting concept and a takeaway for me. It is a good takeaway. Okay, three takeaway points that you want to make sure that we cover before we sign off.
Self-love, to start with. It starts with just being kind to yourself. And even if that is making sure you're drinking enough water, that might be the first thing that you do. You don't have to go, it's not about going and having massive massages and all of this and going to a day spa. That's great. But simple things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you innately know the right foods to put in your body. listen to your body, because your body will always tell you. It's a great communicator. If you're experiencing symptoms of any type, you start with your food. And you know, your body knows, and if you're not sure, you can get guidance. That's where you can work with, you know, someone who can give you some guidance. But you already know. I don't have to tell any woman that's watching this that McDonald's is not the best option for your body.
I think, and that's the thing, is we are smart. We know that, don't we? Yeah. So a second point.
Well, it goes on the same point, but you have the inner wisdom. For whatever it is you're doing in your life, we as women have disconnected so much from our bodies, and we did this at a very young age. When we were told to be ashamed of our periods, ashamed of our body, we disconnected, and we trusted people outside of us to tell us what to do. We wanted a doctor to tell us what to do. We wanted a teacher to tell us what to do. You know, your body knows. Sometimes, once again, you need some guidance to get back to yourself. But you have that wisdom. And this is the time when that wisdom will start to pop itself up and speak. It will start to tell you in various ways that it's time for you to listen. So just stop and listen.
Yeah, stop and listen.
And probably the, the third thing is, I know for me, it's always nature. No matter what's going on, if life is getting really, really tough, if it's stressful, whatever, just take two steps outside the door, or however many steps it takes. If you can do it with bare feet, go outside and just connect to nature. Ground, hug a tree, sit under a tree, whatever it is, nature will always heal you. You will feel better with nature no matter what you're doing. And, you know, I know where I live, I'm lucky. I live on the edge of the bush, and the ocean's right there. I can see the ocean. So I've got bush and ocean. Most people in Australia don't have to go too far to find some nature. Yeah. And even if you can't find it, just grow a patch of grass or something that you can put your feet on.
Yeah, that's so important. And that's something that I, when I walk, it's around beautiful wetlands that they've got, and the bush and everything, and it does, it just being in that space, or walking along the beach for me is just one of the greatest joys. But it's not just the beach, it's in the water for me. Yeah. I've got to walk barefoot, so
yeah,
I can,
with the water, you know, flapping over your feet. And I every Friday I go to the local markets and do my veggie shopping, and then I grab some breakfast there, and then I go down to the beach and I sit on the sand and I eat my breakfast. And then I go and I, you know, dabble in the water a little bit. And I that's actually a non-negotiable for me. It would be pretty rare that I didn't do that. And even when we kind of had all this COVID stuff and we couldn't go to the markets, I still went to the beach. And it's just like, because that is like the end of my week. When I do that Friday morning, that's the end of my week. And I've just reconnected back into nature. And, yeah, and it's so healing. It is just so healing.
Yeah, that's very powerful. Angela, how can people get in touch with you, and what do you want them to do?
Well, I have a website, which is just my name, Angela Council, and that's council spelled S-E-L, .com, so angelacouncil.com. I do have a free ebook called Understanding Menopause, and you can get that on my website. And that just goes through the five things that I've spoken about today, but it also goes through a little bit more about hormones and a few other things as well. So it's just a really good place to start, because women need to understand what's happening at this time of life. So I've put that together. And every 10 weeks I run a 7-day hormone reset. And if you sign up for the ebook, you will be registered in for the hormone reset, where I actually go live and I teach you about hormones and the five pillars that I spoke about. And that's free as well. So I run that every 10 weeks or so. I'm just actually about to run that right now. So the next lot will run, I think, beginning of April or something. But yeah, once you get the ebook, then I take you through a lot deeper into, and it's more practical in the reset. So that's kind of, if anyone wants to know, just that's a good place to start. And then you'll also get links to my Facebook group as well. But that's all in the ebook. And
that's, also- Yeah, that's fantastic. And I know that a lot of people like something takeaway. So that's going to be brilliant. And start focusing that on yourself. Thank you so much for your time and your valuable advice and all the insights, Angela. It's such an important topic and we need to be able to talk about it and not hide it away.
Yep. Thanks for having me.
You're most welcome. And that's another episode of the We Are Women podcast. Thank you so much for joining in and listening. You can also leave a 5-star review if you like. I love those 5-star reviews. They're brilliant. And if you're not sure about where you're heading in your business and everything's a bit clunky for you at the moment, jump onto my website and organize a free strategy call. We can chat for about 20 minutes. And if I can't help you, then I have got such a broad range of contacts. I can put you in contact with somebody who can. But just let's get chatting the first time. So go to JeaneVosper.com, book in a strategy call, and I'd love to just have that conversation with you. I look forward to seeing you on the next episode of the We Are Women podcast. Bye for now.
So, do you feel stuck in a rut in business? Visit speechperfect.com.au and download Jeaneen's free ebook to avoid the 5 most common stumbling blocks women face in business. It's jam-packed full of tips to overcome the barriers that could be holding you back from the success that you dream your business will be. We would love you to leave a review of today's episode and share this podcast with other women in need of entrepreneurial inspiration. Subscribe to the next episode now and join the We Are Women community.